Hi everyone. Good morning and good evening from wherever you are in the globe. I have the pleasure of introducing actually the team that's going to be presenting to you guys. All the way from South Africa, I'm sitting in nice cold chilly Howick, and I'm joined in this webinar presentation by my colleague and highly experienced wattled crane biologist, Laura Jordan. She is our Drakensberg project coordinator in South Africa, and has spent the vast majority of her working career actually on wattled cranes, and joined our team a couple of years ago as our Drakensberg project coordinator. Joining us as well is Hilary Thompson, our whooping crane analyst, our whooping crane guru, who spends most of her time looking at the eastern migratory population of whooping cranes in North America. And then Liz Smith, who introduced you guys all, is our North American Program Director, a great colleague and friend of mine. So it's a wonderful opportunity really for us to share our experiences and our differences and similarities in conserving both wattled cranes and whooping cranes on two different continents of the globe. And I'm just going to touch on a little bit about the wattled cranes and why they decline in South Africa and why all the effort to conserve the species. And from there, I'll hand over to Liz, who will provide a bit of background on the decline of whooping cranes in North America. And from there, essentially, Liz and I will step back and hand over completely to Hilary and Laura to take you on a journey on conserving these two beautifully charismatic species on two continents. So to kick off with some wattled cranes in South Africa, we actually used to have wattled cranes in all provinces of our country, with actually the type specimen that was described in the late 1880s or so was found in the Western Cape, so near Cape Town actually. But unfortunately, in the mid 20th century, we suffered major declines of wattled cranes, largely as a result of urbanization, increased agricultural development, and afforestation, to the point where now we have most of our wattled cranes confined to that small area on the eastern escarpment that you see in South Africa in the bottom corner, called the Drakensberg, or otherwise known as the Eastern Escarpment, where we have roughly about 360 wattled cranes left in South Africa. Our population actually bottomed out to a little under 200 birds, and we are seeing a slow recovery of these species over the last 25 years or so. And I think what's unique to South Africa and interesting is our history. Most of you guys are fully aware of South Africa's history, coming from a British colony through apartheid and to where we are today as a fully independent and democratic state. Our land tenure system has been largely defined by our history, where most of our land is under private commercial agriculture or forestry or other development companies. And interspersed within this landscape, we have these communal lands or grasslands with rural villages that utilize these lands communally for mostly cattle grazing or agricultural lands. But in recent times, and as a priority for our government moving forward, we are looking at redistributing land and looking at improving our equality in this country. And this provides also unique challenges and opportunities as an organization, both the Endangered Wildlife Trust and ICF, to working with landowners, both private commercial landowners, emerging farmers with newly acquired land, as well as communal rural farmers in those areas. So this picture moving forward is a typical landscape, the typical landscape of South Africa. And where you can see here, largely we've got these large open grassland areas with agricultural lands interspersed. And a lot of our wetlands have also been lost to damming that is used for irrigation. So this is just a nice example of how landscape has changed over the years, and how wattled cranes are finding their space within this landscape and doing much better in recent times, thanks largely to a lot of our conservation efforts. So moving on to Liz and whooping cranes. Oh, sorry, before that. This just summarizes basically our wattled crane population globally on the continent. Like I mentioned, South Africa's population is around 360 birds. Our population is listed as critically endangered. Ethiopia's even fewer birds also listed as critically endangered, but our global population across the continent is listed as vulnerable, with fewer than 10,000 birds on the African continent. So an incredibly large charismatic species, indicative of our floodplain and smaller inland wetlands across the continent. Now moving on to Liz.
Thank you, Tanya. All right. And then I'd like to just give a little bit of background on the whooping crane of North America. So the demise of the whooping crane started in the 1800s. And so the one of the first comprehensive historical distribution efforts was conducted by Porter Allen. He was an extraordinary field biologist, and he was described as a rugged outdoorsman, but a very dedicated family man. He came to Aransas National Wildlife Refuge in 1947, when there were only probably about 30 birds after a low of less than 20 earlier in the 1940s. And he compiled all the different museum collections, any kind of historical records that he could find, and developed this map on the right. And largely the mid-continent of the North America through the Great Plains region was where they were primarily located, but also in the central plateaus of Mexico, and then also wintering along the Atlantic Gulf Coast and Gulf Coast. So moving in on the left, this is his breeding distribution map, going from, you know, three provinces in Canada and three states, as well as Illinois in the United States. Later, just more recently, Jane Austen and others confirmed his historical records and also found more and actually added to this distribution range. And in both, you can see that the green dots are actually the breeding birds, but there's also the yellow submarine birds, which had a larger range that went into Wisconsin and Michigan and other states. But Illinois was the southernmost range for the breeding. So this was a land cover map from the mid-1800s conducted by the General Land Office in Iowa. And it was a large prairie at the southern end of the prairie pothole region, interspersed by woodlands along streams and rivers. And then the next one shows 2001, how this conversion to agriculture has pretty much eliminated all of the prairies and the pothole wetlands in Iowa. And so, you know, looking at this, this was a reintroduction. It did not have a landscape that would support what we hope to be a large population. So we have recovered up to around 800 birds. This is from 2019. And you see that there's about 500 in the Aransas Wood Buffalo migratory population, and then the three reintroduced populations in green, and the eastern migratory population. So these maps were very useful in looking at where could we possibly put a reintroduction site for a migratory population in the eastern flyway. And so what Hillary will be talking about is our work in that flyway going from Wisconsin down to Florida.
Thanks, Liz. So today, Laura and I are going to talk about both the whooping crane and the wattled crane and some of the similarities and differences in not only their biology, but also in their conservation and in some of the work that we do, which is surprisingly similar, even though we live in different time zones and on different continents. So I'll start with the biology of the whooping crane, which you can see here on the left. So whooping cranes typically start to breed in the springtime, usually in April, and kind of goes into June. They'll lay 1 to 2 eggs, but a lot of times both eggs will hatch, but typically they would only raise one chick. Their second egg is kind of an insurance policy in case something happened to one of the eggs. The chicks will follow their parents and learn from their parents throughout the summer. They typically learn to fly or have fledged around 80 days of age. So usually mid to late summer, they're able to fly. And at that point, they are really able to get away from predators much more easily, and their chances of survival really go up. In the fall, they start to migrate with their parents. They'll migrate south to their wintering grounds, stay with their parents through the winter, and then many times they'll also stay with their parents on their migration back north. And once they reach the breeding grounds again in the late winter or early spring, the parents will kind of kick them out and tell them to leave the nest, and then they can get ready to start all over again and lay eggs again the next spring. Once the juveniles leave their parents after about a year, they typically do what we call juvenile wandering or spring wandering, where they will travel around with maybe a couple of other young whooping cranes, or sometimes with sandhill cranes, and just kind of move around a lot, look for different areas and different habitats, and possibly encounter other whooping cranes or find places that they might want to set up their breeding territory once they get old enough. They can start breeding at 2 years old, but it's more typical that they would find a mate and start nesting when they're 3 to 5 years old.
Thanks. And then the Wattled Crane here is a winter breeder. And so winter for South Africa is June, August. So we're in the middle of breeding season right now. They also lay 1 to 2 eggs, but they only ever rear one chick. And they, that chick stays with the parents for 7 months, where the parents then fly the birds to join other birds that are single, i.e. non-breeding. And that, you'll hear me talk about the non-breeding flock, and we'll refer it to as the floater flock. So sort of just different English. And then once the chicks have sort of joined the floater flock, the parents tend to return back to the territory. So they stay on their territories, because otherwise other pairs would come in and take over those nests. So the floater flock and the individuals joining can stay in that flock for a long time and obviously never breed. The floater flock counts for about 50% of the whole population. And breeding tends to happen, we originally thought around 4 to 6 years old, when the bird's about 4 to 6 years old, but we have now seen as the population's increased, they actually breed as young as 2 years old. So the wattled cranes tend to live till around 40 years old in the wild, 20 to 40 years old. But the oldest in captivity was 86 years old, so pretty old. Yeah.
So many species of cranes, including whooping cranes and wattled cranes, depend on wetlands, and they really can be a flagship species for wetland protection, but the wetlands really provide them a lot of protection as well. So whooping cranes and wattled cranes will use wetlands for nesting. Since they can't perch in trees, they have to nest on the ground, and by making a pile of vegetation in the middle of a wetland, that enables them to see predators coming from farther away, but they can also hear land-based predators coming if they're walking through the water. So that gives them a heads up if something's coming and gives them a chance to respond. For the same reason, they also use wetlands at nighttime. They'll stand in the water to roost, and while it's dark and they can't see predators, that also kind of gives them a heads up if a predator is coming. They can hear the splashing in the water and can fly away or react in some way.
Similarly, wattled cranes also, you can see that this is a nice nest site. With the mound and the little chick that's hatched from the camber trap, they're totally dependent on wetlands for breeding and also for roosting. So you'll tend to get large groups forming at the roost sites. And we do have some roost sites where around 150 gather. So there's some pretty key areas within South Africa that are important to the species on wetland basis alone.
So the wetlands that cranes use throughout the year can look pretty different. This photo here on the left is a state wildlife area here in Wisconsin where we have a pair of nesting whooping cranes. And you can see this wetland is pretty expansive. There's lots of shallow water and some emergent vegetation. When the crane is standing on the nest, they can see a pretty far way away, even far enough to see me coming out to their nest to put up a camera. You can see the bird here in the background that's doing some threat displays while I'm taking pictures of its nest, not too happy with me. But whooping cranes in the migratory population in the eastern US, they'll winter kind of anywhere south of Wisconsin, pretty much. Some of them will only go as far south as Indiana and Illinois, and some will go all the way down to the Gulf coastal Florida. And as you can imagine, at least for our North American attendees to our webinar that know that landscape, there are pretty different wetlands in southern Indiana compared to in Gulf coastal Florida. So they can use these big expansive wetlands, but sometimes they'll also use just flooded agricultural areas, especially during the winter. The picture on the top, it's a little grainy, but you can get the idea that these two whooping cranes are standing in a puddle, basically in a field. This pair actually I saw in Indiana, and they spent the night roosting in that puddle, which I didn't think was a very good idea, but they made it through the night at least, so I guess they must know better than I do about what kind of wetland they want to use. And the bottom picture here is them in a mud flat on a river. So wetlands are important, but they can also be really different, and they use them for different things too.
Okay, wattled cranes, also, they come with quite a variety of nest styles and houses. So you can see here, this is an aerial survey picture, the green blob in the middle of the water on the big picture, that is a nest site. And you've got this beautiful wetland around it, and you know, they're going to be protected from predators. And you know, this would be tough wetlands to work in, but like really great for the birds. And then on the right, we have some of the other situations you find wattled cranes nesting in. And if you look at the top one on the right, you can see just that little bit of water. And to the right of that water, there's a little white blob. You might have to get close in there. And I'm stood on a road. And so that bird is nesting, that pair is nesting right next to the road there. And so it's at least it's a nice area, and there's another pond in that territory, but yeah, they're nesting right there. And then this bottom photo is another nest site, and that is literally a puddle. And they have actually produced a chick here, not all the way to fledging. I have to say, in their defense of choosing such a terrible nest site, it had a really good view. But they obviously hadn't been thinking too much about rearing the chick. So there's some very varied nest sites. With the roosting sites tend to be on open water edges or within wetlands, much like the nesting sites. But obviously wetland areas that generally are big enough for a few birds, although we do get some floater flocks that are quite small. But generally, at the moment, we have a local roost site which has around between 20 to 30 birds a night, but we do know that they go up to around 150. And the gradient on the water edge of those roosting sites is probably really important, so that there's enough room for all of them to roost safely at a specific depth in those sites.
So as we mentioned, whooping cranes and wattled cranes both nest in wetlands. They'll lay their eggs there, and you know, the water will provide some safety for them while they're incubating the eggs. But once the chicks hatch, they also are out in the wetlands for the period of their life, typically between when they hatch and when they can fly, and can fly between different foraging sites. So the whooping crane here on the left, the two little fuzzy chicks on the nest are pretty young, maybe a day or two old. They'll typically stay on the nest just a couple of days, and then they'll start exploring the marsh. So they'll swim. They can swim when they're little tiny fuzzballs like that. And they can find different areas where they can crawl up on some mud flats or vegetation and start to look for food and stretch their legs and start learning about how to be. So you might wonder why the little brown cranes are chicks of big white cranes, but by being brown, that really helps them blend into their vegetation. So that provides them some safety too. They can, before they can fly away from predators, this way they can hide from predators as well. So these are some photos that Lara took of wattled cranes in South Africa, and you can see how well the chick will blend into the vegetation. But in the photo on the right, believe it or not, there is a chick hidden down in there. So sometimes if you, as a biologist, are looking for chicks in the wetland, even if you can see them before they hide, sometimes it's still tricky to find them. So there's been a couple times when we have been looking for chicks, maybe to put leg bands on or something, and even if we know a small area where they've hidden, we'll walk back and forth time and time again and still not be able to find them. So I can vouch for the fact that their camouflage works well.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And I'm just thinking of a time actually when I was searching this wetland, and I literally stood on this little hump of grass to try and get myself a little bit higher. And this bird, this chick, was actually right at my toe, and I hadn't even seen it. And it wasn't even that as well camouflaged as this bird here. So, I mean, they hide so well.
Yeah, definitely.
So the wattled cranes, they have two distinct life cycles, as I alluded to earlier. And it's just really important to understand that because the pairs stay on the nest and the non-breeding birds don't have a specific place to go, they're much harder to survey. So when we're monitoring or surveying, it's more difficult to figure out what's happening with the floater flock, and we'll talk a bit more about that as we go through. But they tend to be found a lot more on the agricultural lands, and whereas the parents are always on the wetlands.
So whooping cranes also have some different kind of life history traits that make them a little bit different. In terms of monitoring, but also in terms of their movements and habitat use. So the population that I work with is the eastern migratory population, that the easternmost on this map, that migrates from Wisconsin down to Florida in the U.S. And this population was most of the birds in the population have been raised in captivity by people in costumes that you can see here in this photo on top. And when this population was first becoming established, the costume-reared chicks were taught to migrate behind the ultralight planes by our partners over at Operation Migration. So when the birds would migrate down to Florida, they're using lots of different types of habitat and have different behaviors on their way south. There are also non-migratory populations of whooping cranes. So there's another reintroduced population that is an active reintroduction project down in Louisiana. And the whooping cranes there are using quite different habitat, even to the birds in Texas or the eastern birds that are wintering down in Florida or that region. So they don't migrate. They stay for the most part in Louisiana throughout the year, and they use some pretty expansive marshes, but they also use a lot of agricultural areas in crawfish farms or rice paddies and that sort of thing. So really different different types of habitat use and movements across populations, even within the same species. Some of the challenges that the eastern migratory population has faced include mortalities due to illegal shootings, which is really an unfortunate thing that has happened with whooping cranes as they're kind of becoming established in new places where people don't know maybe about whooping cranes or don't know that they're in their area. So our team at ICF has really done a great job of doing some whooping crane outreach throughout the flyway. So they're looking at where are the whooping cranes, and they go to the places where there are whooping cranes and talk to people in those areas about just that they have whooping cranes there, what whooping cranes look like, how you can identify them compared to other either cranes, the sandhill crane that we also have in these areas, or to other tall, big white birds that they might see. So that's been a really positive thing that is helping to curb some of the illegal shootings. The other challenge that the eastern migratory population of whooping crane faces is a lack of breeding success. So in about 2007 and 2008, the biologists at Nisida National Wildlife Refuge in Wisconsin, where the core breeding area of this population is, noticed that there was a big emergence of black flies on the landscape. And about that time is when the flies would cover the eggs of cranes and they would cover the birds. They would really bother the birds. They would see lots of head flicks or them rubbing their head on their body and just really being bothered by the flies. And the whooping cranes would eventually abandon their nests, leave the eggs and their nests, and completely leave the marsh. They would go into agricultural fields and wait until the flies were gone before they went back to the marsh. So that was causing a lot of the eggs to fail to hatch. So what we figured out is that if we actually take the eggs out of the first nest of the birds in that area, we can encourage the cranes to leave the area before they're really stressed out by the flies. They'll naturally recycle and lay eggs again in about 10 to 14 days once the flies are not on the landscape. And we call that process forced renesting. And that's really helped us increase the hatching success of eggs in Wisconsin. But now the next step, now that we have chicks that have hatched on the landscape, is to get those chicks to live long enough to join the population themselves. And the kind of benchmark that we use for that is once they've fledged. So once they can fly, like I mentioned earlier, their rates of survival go way up. So if you can fly away from a predator, you're much more likely to live and migrate and become a breeding bird yourself. So a lot of our research and monitoring and tracking that we are doing now is really focused around getting chick survival to be high enough that they can contribute to the population growth. So that might look like monitoring family groups, looking at what types of habitat they're using, what kinds of food they're eating or movements they're having, if there are ways that we can modify breeding area habitat to make it better for whooping cranes, but also looking at experience of adult birds, if maybe they just have to learn over time how to raise their chicks in each landscape, which I'll talk more about as we go through the presentation.
Oh. So for the wattled cranes, so in the wetlands, some of the greatest effects that can affect nest sites is burning practices and the time. So burning practices are common in South Africa this time of year because they put burn breaks into the landscape so that you don't get runaway fires, and it helps to bring new growth and not let the grassland get moribund. So it's an important part of the landscape, but if that those things are happening at the wrong time of the year, not only do you sort of deteriorate your grasslands, but you can also kill wattled crane chicks or nests that are breeding during that practice. So during that period. So we work alongside some of the threats around cattle as well, which can have been known to kill wattled crane chicks, just because the young bulls come in close, and the mums come in to protect them. But so poorly managed or grasslands is a big threat to the nests, and also changing in wetlands, changing in water flow, also affects the nest sites. Forestry has been another big impact on the landscape which wattled cranes live in, and you can see on this bottom photo that the grasslands has indigenous forests in between in certain areas, but in the top photo you can see it's just timber forests, and the timber forests also consume a lot of the water which would normally go into the wetlands and the ecosystem. So that has also increased problems. And then we have wattle and other alien tree species that humans use a lot but don't necessarily manage in the landscape, and they can cause threats and take over grasslands and wetlands. Other problems include, go to the next slide. Other aspects of the Drakensberg, it's incredibly fertile and rich area. So it's one of the key areas for dairy and maize farming. Then the top area, you can see dairy farming. And then in the bottom area, you can see the maize. Now that maize, when the maize is cut and harvested, you get a lot of fall away of maize, probably similar to in America. And that's what the wattled cranes come and feast on in the Midlands. And so we see this seasonal movement where they come to where the maize is growing and using the maize. And then after that season, they tend to go to the larger floodplains further in, towards the Eastern Cape. Eastern Cape. Okay. Other threats include some power line collisions, although it's not a huge problem because the wattled cranes are quite sedentary. But for the floater flocks and the young birds, they tend to move much more. And like I mentioned earlier, it's difficult to know where they're going to move to. Other problem areas that we get, we can get dog pestering from either dogs living on commercial farms or from communities. And they do disturb the nest sites or, kill the chicks. And then also we have, just in the bottom, this is a typical rural communal scene where you've got cattle roaming around, not necessarily being able to fence off certain areas because of the poverty. And then that can also, again, disturb the birds nesting. It's fine. I can see there's a delay. Other issues are lead we're picking up in grey crown cranes, which are also a wetland species. So we are just keeping our eyes open and trying to work out if that's affecting wattled cranes as well. So this would be typically what we would see for a pristine grassland in the top photo with a wetland, and there's a couple of nest sites up there. And then in the bottom, this would be a typical floater flock scene, which is a maize field. And when the maize is cut, you get these stubble fields like this. And this is where the birds come to forage. And you tend to see quite a large group of them when they're foraging in these areas.
You have a banded bird in there too.
Yeah.
That's right. All right. So all these kind of different parts of the crane's life all kind of play into how the success of the population goes. So, it's not just one part of their breeding season or of their life cycle or one area that they use that contributes to the growth of populations. It's a lot of different things. So when we're working in conservation and trying to understand the threats that a population or a species is facing, we have to really have a kind of well-rounded picture of their life cycle and what are the things that are maybe holding them back from having a you know, longer lives or better population growth or something like that. So we do both for whooping cranes and for wattled cranes. We have strong monitoring programs where we are monitoring breeding pairs and their nests, maybe the locations of their nests or the habitat around their nests, how their eggs fare, if they hatch chicks and how their chicks do, how long they survive, what kinds of threats their chicks face, adult survival, some regional movements for the floater flocks in particular for wattled cranes, trying to understand the areas that they're choosing to go and how their movements are impacted by different factors, as well as migration routes and maybe threats or habitats that they're encountering along migrations or in the wintering grounds for whooping cranes. Included in some of those movements or different areas that they're using throughout the year are also looking at what areas are important for foraging as well as for roosting, threats that they're facing at any of these places, that whether they're new threats that are emerging as the population grows or potentially threats that we already know about that we still have to kind of keep tabs on and monitor to inform some of our conservation actions. And then we also monitor the population's dispersals, how they're expanding across the landscape or what new areas they're starting to use as land use changes, that kind of thing. And then also looking at territorial behaviors between birds or between other species of cranes to see how that might be impacting their nesting success and behavior. One way that we do all of this, a big part of it is by monitoring individuals. So especially for whooping cranes, we really rely on tracking individuals throughout their life. But for any banding or ringing project, it helps us understand individual adult survival, but also their movements. So we can put on unique leg band combinations for each bird. So you can see in the picture of the whooping crane here on the left, this bird has three colors on its left leg and two colors on its right leg. There's also a transmitter there on its right leg. And by looking at that combination on each leg, we can tell which bird this is. And by knowing which bird it is, we can know who its parents are. We know where it goes in the wintering grounds, if it has a mate, if it's raised chicks. So it really allows us to collect a lot of valuable information. We also use a variety of different types of transmitters, and the transmitters tell us different types of information as well. So the top photo of the leg bands and transmitters there, the one on the left is a radio transmitter that sends out a unique frequency signal that we can pick up with an antenna, but we have to be nearby to the bird to pick up the signal. So we kind of have to have an idea of where the bird's going to be, but it helps us to identify individuals if we can't see the leg band or to maybe find them if we're nearby. We can get a lot of valuable information that way. And we also have used either self-tracking technology or satellite transmitters similar to the one on the right that just gives us GPS points for the bird. So we can't see what it's doing or if it's with anyone else, but we can tell if it's moving around, what type of habitat it's in, where it's going and when, which is really valuable.
Yeah, that's good. So all this interesting and hard work that we spend, now we spend a lot of time monitoring the nest and we have to monitor the nest and when to put the rings on. So we spend a lot of time doing that. And this is, although it doesn't look very inspiring, this is like 25 years of work of ringing. And what this is showing us is the different survival rates within different areas. And it really is just, I mean, you don't need to worry about the science, but this is for the wattled cranes. And it really just takes such a long time to collect all this data up. But the reason is so we can monitor survival of the population from when the rings are put on to the chicks. But that doesn't necessarily tell us survival on the nest before the rings get put onto the chicks. So there's two differences of survival.
And it's really hard to put those leg bands on, isn't it? Yes. Takes a lot more effort than it looks like it should.
How many do you do? Yeah.
So since most of the whooping cranes in the population that I work in are raised in captivity, we have the advantage of being able to put them on before we release birds. So many of them will get bands in that way. But we do try to capture all the wild hatch chicks that are fledging in the wild so that we can learn about their lives too and see how their behaviors or survival is different from the birds that are raised in captivity. So it kind of depends on how many chicks survive for how many we try to band. This year I think we've done 4 so far and we're hoping to band 2 more, but one of them was in an area that was much easier for a whooping crane to walk through than for us humans to walk through. So that one, we'll see if we can outsmart it. But so far, it's gotten the better of us. But yeah, how about you?
Yeah, so I totally hear what you're saying. I mean, even though we monitor all these nests, you know, there's a high failure on the nest. So about 30 to 40% of the birds don't make it from the nest. And then when they do, you've got to catch them. And, you know, we have some, you know, if you catch them quite young, but before they, well, big enough that they can't fly. And sometimes, you know, they just go and hide, like we saw in the photo earlier, but then sometimes they just run. And
yeah,
and then it becomes a lot of work. Yeah. I mean, I remember one time we had this awesome plan and we used a quad bike to reach the chick. And I jumped off the quad bike. I was literally 2 meters from it. I ran after it and it went straight into a tall reed wetland. And the chick just vanished and I just sunk up to my waist. And that was game over. Chick yeah. won. That did not get run.
The last one that we captured this year was getting really big. I was worried that if we got close to it, it would miraculously learn how to fly. But thankfully it didn't, but when, you know, it was hiding, but it was pretty big and it was already pretty white, so it wasn't going to be able to hide very well from us. And, once we got close, it decided that it was better to stand up and defend itself than to hide or run. So, yeah, one of our staff had to have kind of a face off with the whooping crane chick who thought it was maybe bigger than it thought, but, yeah, so always exciting, always lots of hard work. Yeah. So some of the payoffs from all that hard work is looking at some of the information that we get from these transmitters. So this is an example of some of the transmitters that I mentioned that we have on whooping cranes that collect GPS points. So these are from 2 different birds. Just to give you an example of their migration. So these two spend the summer in Wisconsin and one migrates down to the Mississippi River between Missouri and Illinois and the other goes down to northern Alabama. So they don't move around a lot when they're on their breeding or wintering grounds, but you know, then they make these really big movements down for their migration.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and while they're doing that, they're potentially migrating with other whooping cranes. A lot of times they'll just migrate in pairs or in family groups, but sometimes they'll meet up with other whooping cranes along the way. And then once they reach their breeding or their wintering grounds, they are a lot of times they will be with other whooping cranes. There's a couple of different areas in the flyway that whooping cranes will kind of group up in the winter, which is a little bit unusual. This picture on the left is actually from Texas, from the wild population. And in Texas, a lot of times they will have winter territories or home ranges where the pairs will occupy over the winter and they'll defend it from other pairs of whooping cranes. But in the eastern flyway, we do see them hanging out with sandhill cranes in the winter time or in larger groups. So some different behaviors, but some of those transmitters and leg bands can help us kind of get that bigger picture idea of what they're doing throughout the year.
That's great. So wattled cranes, the same. We've done 11 trackers now, and you can see this movement. They move regionally. They don't move as far. It's about 300 kilometers. And you can just see that they live in one area. And this bird is near Underberg, and it flies to the areas where there's much more maize and stubble, although there is some in Underberg, and then it flies back. And we just see this regional movement, but it's definitely there. And it takes 2 days to do that flight. And we were really surprised to learn on the tracking data that that's only how long it took to get. And this bird goes, these birds go all the way to the Eastern Cape, Sea Duval. So you can see here some of the chicks that we've put trackers on. And you can just, it's really interesting to see that the chick, you never quite know what these floating flock birds are going to do. And you can see if you follow the purple route up to the top, this one bird just did its own thing. Everyone else was going to Sea Duval and coming back, but this guy just shot off to the Free State. The tracker unfortunately stopped then, so we're not quite sure what happened. There is reports of a small population there, but it just shows how difficult it is to see how and where these birds are going to move to when they're not held bound to a territory.
We had a transmitter recently that one of our younger birds was over in Michigan on the other side of Lake Michigan from Wisconsin, and we didn't think that whooping cranes would fly over Lake Michigan. It's pretty wide, pretty big lake, and they can't see across it. And we had transmitter data that showed one of the birds flew straight across the lake. So they do weird things sometimes, and I think without these transmitters, we probably would never have known that would happen.
Very cool.
So another way that we can collect data on cranes is to do aerial surveys. So for whooping cranes, this is really important. We use them a lot, especially during the nesting season, because some of the marshes that we work in are just really expansive. And unless you're in the right place at the right time, you might not ever see a pair or their nest. So we use aerial surveys throughout the breeding season, mostly to locate birds in general, but also to locate their nests. Like I mentioned, a lot of them do have radio transmitters. So the plane actually is equipped with antennas. They can listen for signals from birds from the air to tell who's who, or listen if they're, you know, maybe not seeing them right away from the air. This is a zoomed up photo. It looks a lot closer than it probably would if you were actually in the plane. But still pretty neat that from the air we're able to get some more information about where these birds are nesting, how many eggs they have, and if their eggs hatch. We also take advantage of the fact that they tend to nest in similar areas from year to year. So our surveys typically are covering areas where we know whooping cranes have nested before. That really helps us kind of narrow down where the nest sites might be. It also helps us monitor chicks as they get older. They're like we were talking about earlier about how camouflaged they are. It is really hard to monitor them from the ground. You almost never see them. Sometimes you just have to look at the adult's behavior and see if you can tell if they're acting like there's a chick that they're either trying to hide or maybe trying to feed or that kind of thing. So we use the aerial surveys a lot for that, but we also can get other information from them, like information about the landscape or the habitat that they're in. So here's an example of one of the marshes where we have some nesting whooping cranes. And just to give you kind of an idea of how expansive some of these areas are, be really hard to, if they're hard to walk through, I can attest to that for sure. And if you don't know where you're going or where the cranes might be, it can be a long walk.
Yeah, that looks hectic.
So this, these little ponds that you can see here on the one on the left in the bottom right-hand corner of the left pond, you can see two little white dots. Those are whooping cranes. This pond actually was created for the Penn site when they were doing the ultralight program. So they would raise chicks in these ponds. There would be a pen around it, and the runway for the planes would be kind of in the bottom right part of this picture. But now that the program isn't running anymore, the pen is gone, but the ponds are still there. And actually the male of this pair was raised by ultralight and has kind of set up his territory in that spot. So it's kind of interesting that they really didn't move too far from home.
That's great. So we were just in the process of doing our 28th aerial survey. The aerial survey was originally planned over the nest. You can go to the next slide. And you can see there's been a steady increase since 2000 up to 81 nest sites that we monitor. And we can continue. And so this is the sort of pictures you get from the air. So if we see a floater flock, we actually just take a picture because it's impossible to count them when everyone's moving. But then also we can often see, well, we can see if birds are incubating, but also we can see the chicks quite often when the birds stand up because we've flown over. Can go to the next slide. One of the key important areas is to be able to tell what has changed in the landscape and if there's any illegal activity. And I talked about water and drain and water levels. You know, some people do break the law and make channels like this that not only disturb pristine grasslands, but also drain water away. So there is no real way of monitoring that unless you're in the air. And one of the important factors as well as looking at cranes is identifying any illegal activity in the landscape. And we can see that we just do a maximum number, but this maximum number does vary quite a lot because the floater flock, and we don't always capture all the floater flock within the aerial survey. And one of the problems is because we have big mountains, the Drakensberg flying, it can be quite dangerous. It's not for the inexperienced pilot. And so you can't always do consecutive days. And of course, birds have wings and they move around. But we can use this data, importantly, to see the maximum number. And we're definitely seeing an increase over time. So that's really important.
We also use cameras to collect data. We, both of us use camera traps for different reasons, but for whooping cranes, we use them a lot for nest monitoring, particularly to look at if the eggs hatch and when they hatch. So we do use remote cameras as well as some handheld cameras to collect behavioral data. And this is an example of a time lapse that one of our interns made about looking through some of the nest camera photos. You can see when the chicks hatch and lots of other good information, different behaviors or visitors to the nest. You can see it pulling up some vegetation to build up the nest mound a little taller in case the water levels go up. You can look at who's incubating, when they're coming and going. So lots of good information from there.
Oh, sweet. Yeah, we also do nest monitoring. We only actually do one aerial survey a year, so the rest of our monitoring is on the ground. So we try to go to every site 4 to 5 times a year, and we try to monitor 60 of the 80 sites. So it's a lot of work, as I was talking about earlier, but fortunately, some of the nest sites are super close to the road, so we can get a few in the day, but a lot of the sites are, a walk away at least, or a bumpy ride. So, but it's really important to understand why there's so many failures, and you can see from this table, there's a lot of chick predation. So, but the other, non-viable eggs, there's a number of reasons why breeding success or survival on the nest is low.
So then to kind of like pull all of this together, we also, it is really important for us to do ground surveys as well, where we can see the leg bands. We can observe birds' interactions with each other, other behaviors and habitat use. We will capture birds to redeploy transmitters if their batteries die. And if we have a bird in hand, then we also can take advantage of that to do a health check, get kind of baseline health information about the population and monitor any sort of threats in that regard. But we also, it also gives us a chance to work with farmers or landowners or land managers to protect the habitat where the cranes are on the ground. Here's a map on the right of the winter distribution from this last year of the eastern migratory population of whooping cranes. And if you look over to the map on the left, that's a distribution of our whooping crane tracking volunteers. And you can see that we have a lot of volunteers in areas where there are cranes that help us keep tabs on the population during the winter. So we really appreciate not only working with landowners or land managers on the wintering grounds and on the breeding grounds, but we also really appreciate all the help from our volunteers who spend a lot of time driving around looking at cranes and telling us what they find. We also rely on reports from the public. So if you are out and you see a whooping crane, you can let us know, and that information filters through me and goes into our database, so we can kind of help keep track of where birds are. So you can find that reporting form on ICF's website.
Yeah, I totally agree. We do the same. We have a little app that you can download in South Africa. And yeah, we also really appreciate the help keeping tabs on where the birds are and what's happening. And that little to the right, the Survey 123, the app we use. It's volunteers are really helpful and important. So keep your eyes open.
Yeah, so by kind of putting all this together, we're able to work with people who are really the heroes in conserving the land where the cranes are. So we couldn't do this all alone. We work with folks who maybe just own some property that have a whooping crane on it, or maybe they're a manager of some kind of preserve where there are cranes. So really kind of starting from the ground up, making connections with people who care about cranes and who work to conserve cranes throughout the year. And I'm sure you do the same in South Africa.
Yeah, totally. We have a stewardship program where farmers willingly choose to protect the landscape that is on their farms. And that means entering into specific practices that might not necessarily be financially the best option for making money. But a lot of farmers, you know, are farming because they love the landscape. And so that's why they do it. And we have a crane custodian program as well for just, you know, honoring those people that are looking after the nest sites. And so there's different levels of commitment. But yeah, basically the landowners are the heroes of the story. So education and awareness, I'm sure, is the same for both of us. You know, it's about getting people into the countryside so that they can appreciate what they actually have at their fingertips. And one of the important aspects in South Africa is a lot of people haven't necessarily had that experience. And you can see the hiking club that it's one of the first community-led hiking clubs in South Africa, which our community offers. So Thabo Madlala, he had developed with some friends. And we're gonna just see a video, I'm not sure how well it will go through, of the work that he's been doing.
My name is Thabo Madlala. I work for the Endangered Wildlife Trust under the Southern Trackers Pack. The hiking club started in 2016. It's like a community hiking club. It's focusing on the youth. We educate youth about the environment.
Once we figure lapezulu, we feel as if we are connected. And sometimes we babuye bangaiboni ivelu ya lezinda we sakhe.
We're focusing on boys, especially, because they are the one who cause the trouble with nature. They also do hunting and also other activities.
We are born in Paragatse, so
After the hikes, they come and tell us what they learned. Some of them, they change their behavior because it's all about changing behavior towards the environment.
Yeah, that's really nice. That's really a cool thing that Thabo's doing. I think it's so important that we work with people, because people are, you know, living in the same landscapes as wildlife and really are what are going to save wildlife. You know, they're going to protect the landscapes if they care about them, and the birds will benefit from that for all things. So that's really cool.
It is. And literally people in that village, they'd lived there their whole life, and it wasn't until Thabo took them. They'd never been to the cave paintings, which were literally a few kilometers from them.
Yeah, that's really neat. So another, I think, really cool benefit of some of the work that we do is that we're able to kind of share knowledge and experience, not even just within ICF or across our programs, but you know, with other conservation programs or with other reintroduction efforts or wetland protection efforts. We can really kind of work with other people, even within our field, for conservation of cranes.
Yeah, I agree. And isolation rearing has been so well rehearsed at ICF. When we did it here in South Africa, we used very similar techniques, just building on the knowledge of people that had gone before us.
Pretty neat to see the different costumes. I'm so used to seeing the whooping crane ones. It's cool to see how you've adapted it there. So,
yeah, on a budget.
All right, so we'll hand it back over to Liz to wrap up.
Great. Thank y'all very much. You know, this is a fine example of how ICF works around the world to affect change. And we're fueled by our passion to save these birds. And it's actually accomplished by small teams in our different regions. And it gets us through all of these challenges that we in the cranes face. So I really appreciate y'all sharing your lives and your stories today. It's been amazing. So I'd like to ask y'all one final question. What can we do to help save cranes?
Sure. So I think, you know, for the International Crane Foundation is really a member-supported organization. Much of our funding comes from members or donors. So I think the first step you can do is become a member, and that also gives you a lot of really cool opportunities and information about some of the programs, not just our programs, but some of the others around the world as well. You can also donate at our website at savingcranes.org. And if you were particularly inspired by one of our programs, you can include that in the note if you'd like to donate directly to one of the programs we talked about today. But we also appreciate donations for other programs as well. But otherwise, I think, you know, it's really important just for people to be aware of some of the threats that cranes are facing, being aware of that cranes are in your area, being excited when you see them. You can always share with your friends and neighbors something that you learned today and maybe teach them something about cranes they might not have known. You can come visit us next year at the Crane Foundation if you're in North America, or if you're abroad and want to take a big trip. Our new site will open next spring, and I'm sure it will be lovely and well worth the wait. So yeah, there's a few ideas there.
Thank you.
Did you have anything to add to that, Lara?
No, I mean, EWT and ICF work together. So similarly, if you're in South Africa, or even if you're abroad, we join us, find out what we're doing. We do lots of stuff as well. And yeah, get involved. I mean, really, you know, enjoy the landscape. Teach other people to enjoy it. Take people that have never been there to appreciate cranes, to appreciate the landscape they have. And obviously protect water. Water is vital, and don't waste it.
All right. Okay, I want to thank you again for our From the Field sponsors, Eleanor and Lee Hoagland, and appreciation of this superb International Crane Foundation global team, of which we're all very proud to be a part of. And then again, if you'd like to learn more about our sponsoring a webinar, contact Kate. And I'd also like to ask you to join us for our next From the Field webinar, Conservation Technology, Fun with Databases and Maps to Ensure a Future for Cranes Around the World, presented by Dorn Moore, who is our Geospatial and Information Services Manager, and a fantastic resource for all of us. And that'll be next Thursday at 11 a.m. Thank you.